All good.
We've got a little stock of your drink twice to
be. Yes, it is now counting down again. Yes. Double tap.
I always try and take a backup recording just in case there's a technical failure with folks in the AP. Because there's no point going to all this work to think this stuff through for over 40 people. You know, the last one that I did here wound up with about 3,500 people on a mortgage club online. And at that point, we're actually beginning to add some value to the discussion. You know, anybody that's talking about anything remotely interesting or complicated, for God's sake, make sure you're talking on tape. Put it on the internet. Google steers people to your words, and they can learn from what you have to say. There are no small rooms, not the internet. So, going forward from where we are right now, in kind of state of human mode, I think that what we're going to get is an enormous expansion of how much contact ordinary people have with technologies which are beyond their comprehension. And the need to be able to take these technologies, figure out what is essentially true about them, and then communicate that to people in a way that will allow them to make intelligent decisions about how the technology affects their life, is going to be enormously key to whether these technologies are hated and feared, or whether they're acknowledged, respected, and eventually given a bit of grudging affection. I don't think anybody's going to love these technologies at any kind of mass scale, because I think that we're getting to the point where our human limits are being thrown in our face increasingly by technology. And there's no way until we break into a completely new way of thinking about our relationships with machines that these dialogues are going to be easy at a cultural level. You know, socially, we haven't really recovered from the, for example, the invention of television, which was a huge distorting force for our culture. Relationships between men and women have still not settled down after the invention of birth control. It takes us a long time to culturally adapt to a new technology. So we're at a point where, you know, VR, AR, and all the other horsemen of the apocalypse are coming right over the horizon. They're impacting our human culture. And our ability to narrate and storytell what those technologies mean to people, not just in a sales way, but in a political or a socio-political dialogue, is the core of our ability to generate a kind of socio-technical milieu, a discussion about the role of tech in society, that will enable us to come to good decisions. So many of the governments in the world are currently putting a ton of effort and energy into looking at what blockchains can do for them. And what most of them have done is they've looked at the blockchain as it was when they had first contact with it, when it was doing a few transactions a second, and if you wanted it to go faster, you needed a permission system. When it had no ability to scale, no ability to encrypt, it had no homomorphic features, it was a relatively limited technology. And they've built a world model based on that technology. And now when you talk to government about blockchain, what you hear is a whole bunch of discussion about the state of the art as it was shortly after Ethereum was launched, which is generally speaking when people first started talking about it. If you talk to finance people inside of government, they heard about it 2 years before that at the peak of the initial noise around Bitcoin. And for them, they're still struggling with the idea that the blockchain is something other than Bitcoin. It's just a transactional medium, right? That doesn't affect us at all, that doesn't help government. So once people walk into their head what a technology is, they get very fixed around that idea, and it doesn't leave much room for understanding that the next time they see that technology will wear a different face. And the next time they see it after that, it will wear a different face. And the next time you see it after that, it will wear a different face. Right? And it's not that all of these faces are basically the same face over and over again, like Doctor Who, where it's the same set of capabilities with new graphic design. It's that you actually get an entirely new generation of capabilities. And the jumps are not unfamiliar to us. Right? Phone used to be an electromechanical box connected to a cable by a wall. Connected to a wall by a cable, with, you know, something like 48 volts running down it to operate the ringer and the microphone. That used to be phone. Then phone became something like a little Nokia with a bunch of buttons on it, and it was wireless, but it didn't have any web access. Then phone meant something with a little screen that, you know, you could just about browse a website on. Then phone became something with all those features and a camera and a video recorder and an MP3 player, and then it became, you know, phone. And if you pick up somebody's modern phone, you know, iPhone 6, Samsung S7, something along those kind of lines, what you have is a very, very functional laptop that they left the keyboard off, running an extremely sophisticated operating system that's actually much more user-friendly than and we still refer to this as phone. Similarly with blockchain to government or large companies. Blockchain is the first version they solve. They're still back wondering, is it a dial tone? Hands up if you haven't actually ever heard a telephone dial tone. Right? It's become part of the past. The static, as you see at the beginning of each of the HBO shows, you know, that was cosmic rays interacting with electric wire loops called antenna. Right? You see it on YouTube as well. The actual original mechanism to give rise to that static is long gone. You know, why do you have a 3D printout of the same icon? Oh, that's actually a floppy disk. It's a floppy disk. So one of the things that we have to start teaching people when we introduce them to new technology is we have to introduce them to the idea that they're getting on a ride which is going very steeply up a curve. So this is this thing called the blockchain. Today it looks like this, tomorrow it will look a little different, the day after that it will look different again, and 5 to 10 years from now we expect it to be kind of sort of something like this. And introducing people to the idea that what you're showing is a little seedling in a pot for a tree that will be 100 meters tall with roots that go down 35 feet. You know, that sort of thinking is quite difficult for us to do because what we're introducing people to is not objects, we're introducing them to processes. This is the blockchain process. It's an evolutionary system that will produce a bunch of different technologies one after another, and that evolutionary system is self-funding to the tune of several $1 billion. It has hundreds of activists that have made enough money from that process to be able to work on anything they like for the next 3 to 5 years, some of them for the rest of their lives. And that socio-technical system will continue to generate enormously sophisticated artifacts, each one building on top of the one before it, until we're at a point where there's nothing immediately visible that you want to add. So we know that at point X, where X might be 5 to 10 years in the future, we will have a blockchain system that works at 5, 10, 15, 50% the speed of all the computers in the network put together. So if you have 100,000 computers, it will be 50,000 times faster than the fastest computer in the network, maybe. It will probably be programmable in a bunch of different languages, a bunch of different paradigms. It will probably host limited artificial intelligences, and it will probably be interwoven with almost any device that you can imagine it being interwoven with. And that blockchain, some people occasionally refer to as scum, is completely inevitable as soon as you have the blockchain that we have today, plus enough money for people to continue to build it, because every step towards that technology is profitable to take, and there is no regulatory framework which can stop people creating those technologies. And I don't mean this in a kind of fist-waving, fight-the-state, old Bitcoin libertarian way. I simply mean that we don't have any regulatory framework as a society for globally rejecting the technology because we don't like its implications. The last time we managed that was CFCs to protect the ozone layer, and that was a very, very rare, like, once-in-a-century moment of cohesive action from global government. On things like carbon emissions, we've done nothing. Genetic engineering, the organisms that we release into the environment, we have no real structural plan. So the fact that it's almost certain that we will wind up with blockchain which looks like that tells us nothing about the paths that we can take to get there. We know that it will be an awful lot of writing code. We probably know the names and faces of many of the people that will be at the core of that process, but who is to say that the people that begin the race will be the ones that finish it? There may be several generations of technologists and new ideas in there, or it may be built directly on top of the Ethereum platform that proceeds a linear set of breakthroughs from Vitalik. Could go either way. Personally, I think my money is still on Vitalik because he's amazing, but you know, it's open to discussion, it's open to doubt, it's open to people bringing their code. As we begin to talk about the blockchain as evolutionary steps towards this kind of integrated global computing surface, right, we can go back to the story about how to explain it. One computer per organization, one computer per person, many computers per person, which is where we're at now. Finally, one computer per world. All of one computer per person stuff becomes woven together. The cloud gives us a metric for many computers per person being woven into a cohesive whole. We go beyond the cloud into this blockchain, and this blockchain takes all of the stuff that was done for your computing in the cloud and connects it into a single massive single global massive enterprise looks almost exactly like the internet, but now you can make payments on it. And if you give somebody a copy of a picture, only they get to see that picture. So for ordinary people, it may be that by the time you built this essentially perfect global computer network, all that they see is that the internet payment stuff is secure, the credit card stuff is no longer continually getting up, and their passwords don't get hacked. And life goes on with a series of little sequential improvements. But underneath that, we take a 50-60-year-old architecture of connecting computers together, and we pull it out from the existing internet and we replace it with a fully, you know, cryptographic distributed architecture without really breaking the user services that go on top. And this is basically much the same process as we did with the phone. We took the phone, we got rid of the wire, but to get rid of the wire, we had to pull the entire old phone network to pieces and we had to replace it with mobile network. To get from there to the phone as a kind of web browser thing, we had to pull out the entire operating system and processors from the old phones, and we had to reshell that around these little mobile supercomputers that we now call telephones. Mm-hmm. So there's several examples of the things that you can touch every single day of your life that have gone through this process of taking an existing interface paradigm, an existing story, pulled out the technology, put the new technology underneath it without the user really saying a blip. And this is my fundamental kind of state of the union prediction for what's going to happen with the blockchain. I think the blockchain story is going to seamlessly fuse into the web and the internet as we get things like the Brave browser, which is a browser with a Bitcoin wallet built in and ad blocking. And that was done by the guy that invented JavaScript. So the notion that you would simply see web browsers with crypto features and crypto browsers with web features, and the whole thing kind of fuses together around something like IPFS, you know, some bank will issue a stable coin on the dollar that's tied to your account, you can use it as a credit card, and you know, your payments stop making you feel exposed because you know where the money's going, you know, whitelisted addresses inside some private blockchain network maybe. And what you'll see is that the fuss around the blockchain as a separate technology will gradually go away as it simply begins to re-inhabit all of the internet of things devices, all of the web browsers, all of that transaction processing, and most of the cases where you need any kind of secure computation, which could well be things like one-time key logins or two-factor authentication. And once you realize that all of those technologies are running on the same deep interconnected infrastructure platform called the blockchain, or whatever we're calling it, it becomes apparent that we've gone through an enormous civilizational upgrade of a computing infrastructure, but without having to break all the existing paradigms. So I think, and I feel a little exposed to saying this, I mean, I feel like I'm going down a little bit, but I think that the blockchain hype about blockchain as a separate technology will not live out the rest of this year. I think instead, what you will see is an enormous amount of transfer of focus to actual blockchain applications that people are using on a day-to-day basis, and browser-like entities which are connecting to the underlying blockchains, but people will relate to the browser-type entity as what they're using rather than the underlying technology that powers it. For example, everybody knows that they're using Chrome or Firefox. Nobody really understands that what they're really using is the Apache web browser. So the blockchain becoming something which sits in the background and seamlessly and silently powers all of these technological upgrades as we take old broken things and replace them with new fixed things. That's my prediction for the next year. I think by the end of this year, there'll be four or five massive products which are becoming seen as being, you know, the central points of blockchain awareness. And people will realize that this is the blockchain, you know, it's finally arrived, but by the time it arrived, nobody talked about blockchain anymore. They just talked about this new improved web experience they were having. They just talked about the fact that they no longer had to worry about logging in with passwords. They began to talk about like how easy it was to do electronic banking these days. And the notion that part of what happens as we begin to succeed is that you stop seeing your banners flying up over the ramparts where the fight is happening, and instead you see little logos stuck onto the sides of devices when you go down into the market to buy things. This is victory, right? Becoming invisible and becoming part of the weave of society is what happens when you grow from being a kind of little fortress at the edge of the horizon to being a major established part of the integrated network of global trade and finance. And I think that by the time I come back to talk about playoffs 2017, that process will have advanced so far that we wonder why we're talking about blockchain instead of talking about this amazing thing over here, you know, Mist 4.0. My God, have you seen the VR integration? So, I think I've got two little points and then I'll wrap up. So, the first thing I want to stress is that success in these kind of revolutionary technological changes is often really, really unimpressive. Does anybody know who wrote the mobile phone operating system that they're carrying around in their pockets? Bits and pieces, right? And certainly there was some code in there for iOS, but I bet it's 10% of code in your Android, 5%. So, you know, firstly, nobody really notices the infrastructure once it becomes infrastructure. We generate these great leaders and these great heroes at the early stages of the revolution, but once you're fully integrated into the global weave, there isn't really a name for your heroes anymore. They're just people that run companies that build things. So, the point where we were generating these enormous heroic leader figures in the blockchain age, I suspect, is going to draw to a close. This is not a sign of failure, this is a sign of victory. And the second thing is the relationship with the state. And we've really taken a deep toll from libertarian activism around Bitcoin. You know, we had a bunch of guys running around painting targets on themselves on the White House lawn, you know, waving flags, waiting for the Secret Service to come and get them to show that they were cool and hard. And it hasn't happened, because generally speaking, the reaction from the state to Bitcoin is going to be like, could I use that to fix my banks? Interesting. And this is not the reaction that people were ready for at all, because what they expected was to fight and lose. What they weren't ready for was victory. And because victory didn't look like burning down this White House, victory looked like being invited in the front door to come and talk about how this stuff is going to integrate into society. People have gotten confused between winning and selling out. Right? There is no selling out, right? Becoming part of mainstream society instead of being a little fortress off on the horizon is total victory. Right? If there's going to be some kind of large-scale discontinuous social change within my lifetime, I expect it to be globalization and I expect it to be led by climate justice. I don't think it's going to be a libertarian meltdown of everything, and I think it's likely to be a fundamental renegotiation about how we manage the planet as a single ecosystem, in spite of the fact that geographically we're divided up into nation states when it comes to paying taxes. Right, maybe the UN starts taxing megacorporations, and we wind up with a global government with husks and teeth as a result. Maybe we start giving people individual carbon wallets, and all the carbon that you emit is gradually piled up in your carbon wallet, and you have too much carbon, you can't buy and sell anymore without paying a huge tax. Almost anything could happen. And I'm sure that this kind of integrated tech and social weave thing that I'm describing will include many features from blockchain technology. Blockchain and climate is going to be as much of a discussion as blockchain and identity is right now. But it'll take a few years for it to mature, because the climate people have not yet gotten blockchain as a religion yet. But once they do, they're going to be all over this stuff in the same way that the identity people are currently all over. By the way, I'll make a little plug for Uport, to the Consensus Identity product. It's really, really well thought out. Finally, right, our role in that revolution is two things. Firstly, during those revolutions, it's quite a good time to make enough money to buy a house. That's a really good use of your 15 years or 5 years or 10 years in the spotlight. You know, real estate has always been what people did as soon as they made a bunch of fast money. If they were smart, if they were dumb, they kept in fast money and waited for it to double by another five times. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. But this notion that we move into the mainstream and get relatively ordinary lives, rather than running around with, you know, tens of millions of dollars floating around on laptops, which people then lose once in a while. You know, the field is aging, the field is maturing, the field is growing up. I don't want to say that the age of shenanigans is at an end, but the people that were really at the bleeding edge of the shenanigans have been at that bleeding edge for a decade, and it's no longer 21-year-old kids running around breaking the future with their amazing libertarian cryptocurrency. The big guys have arrived, the old guys have arrived, people that were young have grown up. The people that are arriving are no longer at the absolute frontier, they're joining some other generation's revolution. And the entire field is beginning to stabilize into something which is enough mature players, even among the early adopters, they've had enough time to grow up and mature, that they're getting to the age where they can integrate into the process is a culture at stake. So I don't want to declare the revolution is over, we've won, but I think that the integration process is now going to be largely social, because the general direction of the technology is well understood and well set, and many smart people are working on it. The real question is, how do we make a deal with